Hello there, I'm Cristina Elisa Martina. I'm a postdoc in MailerLab, and today I will talk to you about glycans. We will see now an introduction to glycans, and in a second video we will see how glycans are treated and integrated within Rosetta. So in this video we will have a first glycan overview, then we will see very briefly the function that glycans can have in the cell. And then we will go a little bit more deep in glycan chemistry that will be necessary to understand the second part of this introduction to glycan modeling. Okay, let's start from the basic. In the cell, we have four main building blocks, peptides or amino acids, nucleotides, lipids, and carbohydrates. They can associate to form macromolecules like proteins, nucleotides. Lipids can associate without being covalently bound to form membranes. But carbohydrates can be covalently bound to form glycans, also known as polysaccharides or sugar chains. If we consider a single monomer, we can have four different combinations of nucleotides, 20 of amino acids, and 20 of carbohydrates, if we consider just the mammalian carbohydrates, but this number can increase if we consider also the bacterial one. When we go up to two monomers, we can have a combination of 16 for nucleotides, 400 for peptides, and 1360 for carbohydrates. And the reason why this number increases much more than the peptides one is that carbohydrates can be linked in a different way, while nucleotides and peptides are usually just linked linearly in a direction that goes for peptides, for example, for the N-terminal of the protein to the C-terminal, while carbohydrates can be branched. And this, you can see that as we increase the oligomeric size, we increase exponentially the possible combination of sugars. Now, this is not the only complexity bound to glycans. The size also play a role. So in Nature was recorded a glycan chain that contained 35 sugar rings. The length of the chain without branching can go up to 13 rings. And then there is the branching point that is mostly in the first portion of the glycan, but we can have also multiple branching point in the same glycan chain. So this is an example. You can see that the first branching point is here and the second branching point is here. So this increases a lot the complexity of glycans over proteins or DNA. Now, the complexity doesn't stop here, because if we associate glycan to protein, for example, we can form what are called glycoprotein. If we associate them to lipids, we form glycolipids. And really recently, in this paper, was discovered that glycans can also be covalently bound to RNA, forming what I guess is called glycoRNA. But this is not all. We can also have combination of those. For example, in this protein, a glycan that is shown here in green is bridging the protein to a lipid. And you can see and imagine that this combination increases a lot the complexity of working with glycans. And this method is mainly used for localization, so the lipid will be in the membrane and will localize all this protein on the membrane surface. Now, we will not work with lipids. We will mainly focus in glycoprotein. But also within the glycoprotein world, there is a lot of different combinations in which glycans can be added to a protein. For example, through a N-glycosidic linkage, so a nitrogen atom is linking the protein to the glycan, or a carbon atom, sulfur atom, phosphorus, oxygen, or also there are proteins that are glycosylated at the C-terminal portion of the protein. Now, as you can see, we have a lot of variables here. Today we will focus mainly on N-glycosylation through an asparagine residue. And this is what we will use for the tutorial. Let's go really quickly on the function that glycans can have in the cell. In this paper you can find an overview that is shown here in this picture. Glycans or sugars are involved almost everywhere. So transcriptional regulation, cell-cell adhesion, differentiation, cell growth, signaling, and ligand receptor binding. In case of cancer, they are shown to be involved in metastasis, and they are definitely involved in bacterial infection or viral attachment and entry in the cell. Now, I will not go much more deep in those functions. You can definitely find more reference online. What I will mention is something really basic that glycans are involved on and not everybody knows about it. So this is the blood type. As you know, people can have different blood type, 0, AB or AB. And the difference in these is due to glycosylation. So the group 0 has this basic glycan chain and is missing a branching point in here that is present in both group A and B. For group A, we have an N-acetylgalactosamine in this position, while for the group B, we have a galactose in this position. And the group AB contains both of these. And you can now imagine that just this difference of one sugar ring in the blood cell can give a lot of trouble, for example, during transfusion. So sugars, although they are less studied than protein or DNA, are definitely important in the cell. A second function that I will mention today is really bound to what we are going to do in the tutorial, and is glycan masking in viral escape. So you may know some of these viruses, influenza, Ebola, HIV, coronavirus, very recent. They are all enveloped protein, they are all enveloped virus. And those that you can see here are the glycoproteins that are expressed outside the membrane on the viral particle. So this is what the immune system can see. And the blue dots are glycan chain. And you can see that some virus are not so much glycosylated, like Nipah, while other are known to be, and they are heavily glycosylated, like HIV. One of the reasons why viruses develop glycosylation on the glycan protein is to escape the immune system. And in this example, we are considering hepatitis C virus. And what happens usually, we have an infection, but we already have antibodies that neutralize the virus because they recognize this sequence on the glycoprotein that is exposed outside the viral particle. If this glycoprotein mutate, for example, the N become an S in this position, we will form what is called a sequin. We will discuss later about it. But this sequin is recognized by an enzyme that is the glycosidyl transferase that will add a glycan chain at this asparagine. And since this glycan chain is added in here, the antibody that before was neutralizing now cannot neutralize anymore. So it cannot bind the viral protein and cannot tell to the immune system, okay, we have something external that entered the organism, get rid of it. So with this mutation, the neutralization will not happen and hepatitis C virus can enter and infect the system, the host. So it's really important, this concept in viral escape is not the only factor, of course, but we took this idea of using glycans to hide epitopes from the immune system in order to develop, for example, vaccines. And an example of the tutorial will be definitely glycan masking, epitope that we don't want to be recognized by the immune system. We will discuss later about that. Okay, let's go a little bit down in glycan chemistry. In this slide, you can see some common monosaccharides. So monosaccharides can be formed by aldehydes or ketones, and in these slides are shown only the aldehydes. We can have a minimum of 3 carbon atoms in the backbone, so the glyceraldehyde is the one, is the shorter sugar between the aldehydes, and we can go up to 9. So here are shown just 3 carbon atoms, 4, 5, and 6. Now, the glyceraldehyde has a single stereogenic center in here, in the second carbon. So we can have two enantiomers of glyceraldehyde, the L form or the D form. And the same is valid for each of those molecules. So here are shown just in one of the two forms that they can adopt, D or L. But we have a total, for example, of 16 molecules that are formed, sugars that are formed by six atom of carbon, six carbon atom. Now let's take an example. The glucose, here you can see the two enantiomers, D and L, and you can see up here the aldehydic group. So we start counting from the aldehyde group, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And what you can see here is the open form of glucose. But this is extremely rare. In solution, the glucose is mainly formed in a ring and is very rare to find it linear in this way. So the ring formation can happen at different carbon atoms. So the first one can connect to the fourth one, forming a five-side ring that take the name of furanose. Any sugar that have five sides rings are called furanose. So we have here the glucofuranose, because derived from glucose. If we have a connection between carbon 1 and carbon 5, we will have a six-side ring that take the name of pyranose. So we will have a glucopyranose. And here you can see only the D version. Of course, there is also the L version. And also we can have different anomers. So if we check just for the glucopyranose, we can have the anomeric carbon here in 1, was oxydryl is pointing down, so is in trans towards carbon 6, and this will be called alpha D-glucose. Or we can have the oxydryl group attached to carbon 1 that is up, so in cis to carbon 6, and this will be called beta D-glucose. This will be important to understand the linkage. So these two forms are both glucose, are both glucopyranose, but they are alpha or beta anomers. The linkage. To put together two monosaccharides, for example, here we have two alpha D glucose, we will need an anomeric carbon, that is number one. We will need an alcohol, for example, this one, and we will need an acidic environment. What is happening? The oxydryl in here will do a nucleophilic attack on the anomeric carbon, and we will form this glycosidic linkage that is formed with an oxygen, so we will call it O-glycosidic linkage. We will release a molecule of water, and if we want to check now the anomeric state of these disaccharides, we need to check the other carbon, the one that now is anomeric, and again, if the OH group is pointing down in trans to carbon 6, we will call it alpha. If it is pointing up, we will call it beta. Here you can see the two molecules, where the only difference is the orientation of this oxydryl group, and we have alpha maltose and beta maltose. In both cases, the linkage is the same, so we go from carbon 1 in the first molecule to carbon 4 in the second molecule, and since this was in alpha, was an alpha glucose, we will have an alpha 1 to 4 glycosidic linkage. We can also have beta 1 to 4 glycosidic linkage, and this is an example. So this group was pointing upwards in cis to carbon 6. So we are forming a beta 1 to 4. We are still going from 1 to 4 glycosidic linkage. And this is, again, the anomeric configuration is alpha. So here we have an alpha D-lactose. As you can see, the two molecules that I presented, the lactose and the maltose, are exactly the same in terms of atoms, but what changed is the orientation of this linkage. One is in alpha and one is in beta. And they are two different sugars, and lactose is mainly found in milk, while maltose is a derivative from starch. So you can see how the glycosidic linkage may change a lot the chemistry of this sugars. There are also more complex linkage. So for example, here if we start with an alpha D-glucose and a beta D-fructose and we connect 1 to 2, we will have a linkage that is called alpha 1 beta 2 glycosidic linkage. And this is the common sugar, sucrose. Now, this seems very easy and straightforward, and it is. But if you have a bigger glycan chain like this one, things can become more complicated or more messy. So in the representation, you can see that here we have a six side rings. These two are glucose. These nine here are called mannose. We can see the linkage that we have between each connection. So here we have a beta 1 to 4, here we have an alpha 1 to 2, and so on. The full UPAC name for this molecule is shown in here. I will not read it for you. You can try if you want. But you can see that this is a quite complicated way to write it down and remember. So there are other ways that make it more easy and also other way to represent it, like this one. So this molecule is called MANN9 because we have 9 mannose rings that are in green, and N-acetylglucosamine here as a red, a blue square. Again, we can see the linkage, so we know how these sugars are connected, and these make it much more easy to visualize and also to name. So I hope this refresher is going to help you. We will talk again about nomenclature in the Rosetta in the next video, that is glycan in Rosetta. And thanks for listening, and do not hesitate to write me if you have any question. Bye.